nature launches her own offensive in the Solomons. Rainwater becomes runaway rivers, turning Quonset huts into flooded islands. Roads which the Seabees cleared and surfaced are swallowed in mud, breeding ground for a malignant enemy even more deadly and treacherous than the Jap. This enemy, sighted in the microscope, the Anopheles mosquito, strikes silently behind the lines with a devastating weapon. Malaria. The one fear in the minds of brave men, for it has decimated combat forces and postponed military offensives. A tragic toll of American lives has been taken in the struggle against this insect army in the tropics. But the fight for life goes on. The shock troops of insecticide slog into muddy action. Under the supervision of the Medical High Command, the Seabees launch a new offensive against the hidden enemy. Vigilant sentinels of the water supplies, the Seabees install filtering systems to prevent the enemy from sneaking into camp. For the streams are tropical sirens, beautiful, but full of death. But like our enemies, malaria fights a losing battle. The water runs pure, and the men grow strong. Vitality surges through the base again. American laughter. Healthy appetites. Spiritual strength. Another triumph in the Seabees' constructive conquest of the tropics as they go blasting their way through the South Pacific. A new road in 72 hours. Hundred Quonset huts in 8 days. Another airfield 9 days from the falling of the first tree. And so the work goes on. Tree by tree and base by base, the Seabees blaze the path that leads to Tokyo and final victory. How many headline readers appreciate the far-sighted construction program that lies behind those banner lines? Not in 1943, but in 1941. Not in southern Europe, but far off in an inconspicuous Scottish hamlet, began the great offensive on fortress Europe that is so rapidly gathering momentum today. Here the Seabees, under the very nose of the Luftwaffe, completed the base from which Anglo-American combined operations launched its initial drive in the European theater. Before the Navy's builders arrived, there was nothing here but an ancient fishing pier. 2,400 feet of ocean-going docks had to be constructed on the Clyde to accommodate our invasion forces, shoving off for their African adventure. As the rhythm of invasion quickened, the tempo of construction kept pace. At Oran, the causeways that were to play so decisive a part in the invasion of Sicily were assembled and tested. Before Bizet could play the vital role the High Command had assigned to it, every dock had to be restored. Every scuttled Axis ship hogging the harbor had to be raised. Now the curtain was rising on the big show. Bound for Sicily, the largest armada the world had ever seen. While the democratic people of the world held their breath, more than 2,000 vessels labored through angry seas to bring the war to Mussolini's doorstep. In invasion styles, ships that carry their own portable docks, an innovation in landing operations that was originated and developed by the Civil Engineer Corps before the outbreak of the war, receives its baptism in fire. Not even the sailor's Bible, the Blue Jacket's manual, can tell them how to secure the heavy pontoons that form the causeway from which the LST's equipment is unloaded when the shore is too shallow for beach landing. For these Seabees are adding a new page to the handbook of seamanship. As coolly and efficiently as if this were just another practice landing at Norfolk Bay, our amphibious forces barge in on Signor Mussolini. Operation that had become routine in trial landings is a severe test of courage and skill as the causeway cut loose from the LST in a choppy surf sweeps into shore on its own momentum.